Welcome everybody to our second regular tutorial in methods and transportation econometrics and statistics. So in this tutorial we learn the tools of the trade, that means how to handle vectors, matrices and basic operations with them. First a short recapitulation or introduction. First, in econometrics, we will strictly distinguish between row and column vectors. The standard vector with n components is a column vector. It's also a special case of a matrix, an n times 1 matrix. A row vector is just a transposed column vector. And the operation of transposition, some people denote it with an upper script T, another with a dash. I will use the dash because it's less obtrusive. So a dash is just a row of numbers. And in order to clarify, I will set vectors with an arrow above it and matrices as this with a double underline. So it's just at least at the beginning so that the feeling for the objects gets clearer. So an n times m matrix is just a matrix assortment of numbers. So it has n rows, 1, 2, n, and it has m columns. And it's just a regular alignment of numbers. It is nothing special, so it's just a tool of a trade, something with which some calculations can be simplified. Of course, you can also transpose a matrix. Like a vector, you just change, swap rows for column. That means the transposed matrix, just the rows become columns, and the columns become rows. So you just swap the indices. So it's transposed matrix with index ij is just the non-transposed matrix with index ji. So just swap the index, which swaps also the rows and columns. Then there's a general neutral element with respect to matrix multiplication. It's just the unit matrix. My non-neutral element means if you multiply any a matrix with E, you will get the same matrix. And so it's A times E equals E times A equals A. This is also the only exception from the general rule that matrices are not commutative. So A times B is different from B times A in the general. By the way, what is the neutral element with respect to addition? It's just a zero matrix, because any matrix added by a zero matrix will also give this matrix. So finally, the inverse element is just defined that the product of the inverse times the matrix equals matrix times the inverse is the neutral element. Again, here this is an exception of the commutativity. It does not hold in general. So this was just the general overview, recapitulation, introduction. Now we will summarize the arithmetic operations, additions and multiplications we can do with vectors and matrices. So first, addition. Addition is simple, both for vectors and for matrices. You just add it component-wise. That also means for a vector, for example, that the number, the dimension of a vectors to be added must be the same. It's you cannot compare apples with bananas. So only that means vectors of a different number of elements cannot be added. And particularly, a vector cannot be added with a scalar. unless it's a component one vector, which is a degenerated vector, which is a scalar. And it's you will get, of course, again, a vector with any components. And the same with matrices. You can only add matrices with the same number of rows and the same number of columns, and you will get also, as a result, a matrix of the same dimensions, with just each of the component is just added. Multiplication by a number is also easy. You also multiply it element-wise. And there's also no condition. You can multiply vectors by a number, matrices by a number, you just multiply it component-wise. And so you get just the same vector and matrix as you input, multiplied by component-wise by the scalar. Now it gets interesting, the scalar product. The input are two vectors of the same dimension, and the output is a number. That's why it's called scalar, because scalar is a noble word for just a simple number. And you do this operation by multiplying a transposed vector times the normal second vector of the same dimension. You can also do it the other way around, transposed vector B times regular vector A. And this is just the sum of the products of the components. And here you see, by this definition, you see that, of course, because numbers commute, you can, this expression is the same as this expression. Unlike the dyadic tensor product, the only difference is are these small dashes. So here a dashed vector is multiplied with a regular vector, and here a regular vector is multiplied by a dash vector. And unlike the scalar product, you will not get a number, but you get a matrix. And this matrix is has a dimension number of rows of the first vector dimension and number of columns of the second vector dimension. You have no conditions. Depending on the dimensions of the input vectors, you get a matrix of the corresponding dimensions. So matrix times vector, that's basically you multiply the rows of the matrix R scalarly with the vector B. So it's basically, it's just like several scalar products set one below the other. Also there are conditions, because of course the dimension, the number of columns of the matrix must be the number of elements of the vector, because otherwise you cannot calculate the scalar products building each component of this resulting n vector. So the matrix multiplication is just the same. The resulting result is a matrix as well, and its components are calculated. The first index is just the row index of a vector A, and the second index of a resulting vector is just the column index of the matrix B. So it's just a matrix assortment of scalar products, a row of the first matrix and columns of the second matrix. Again, there are conditions, because you can only use the scalar products if the column number of the first matrix is the row number of the second matrix. And you get n kreuz times k matrix. Interestingly, basically you need only to learn this, because all the other multiplication and addition are just special cases. Obviously, matrix times vector is a special case for this, if the matrix B is just a row vector, a degenerated matrix is a row vector. And here both matrices are just vectors. it even works for numbers, because a 1 times 1 matrix is a number, and then you are just end up with a normal number multiplication. So basically, all normal scalar product, tensor product, matrix times vector, multiplication with a number are all special cases of this matrix multiplication thing. After this introduction, we come to the actual problems. So the first problem of the second tutorial is concerns matrix rules. The first task is to show that commutativity is valid for scalar products with a simultaneous transposition. That means A transpose B equals B transpose A, but it's not for general matrix products. AB is unequal BA in general. So the first is simply follows directly by the definition, because it's just both products are just the sum of the products of a single components. And also because both vectors need to have the same size, you can also swap them. In fact, we will show that later that this is a special case of the general rule that matrix and vectors do not commute. But if you swap the order, then if you also swap the transposition, then you have again a correct identity. So now we just show by example that for general matrices, the commutativity, that means that swapping of the order in products does not apply. First, if a matrix is not square, then if AB exists, then BA does not exist because of the conditions that the number of columns of the first matrix needs the number of rows of the second. And if it's not square, this will only be valid for one product, not for the other. So, but it does not work even for square matrices. For example, let's assume that A and B are square matrices of the same size, the same dimension, and let's calculate the first component of a resulting matrix. That means the scalar product of the first row of A times the first column of B. That means the first row of A is, we need of course another summation index, A1k summed over k multiplied with BK1. That's the first row of the second matrix. Now let's do it the other way around. BA 1 1, then we have the first row of B times the first column of A. And if these are different, so we have multiplied out, we have this. And here you see, for example, for the first product, we need the matrix elements A1 1, A1 2, and for the second, we need A1 1, A2 1. So if these are not symmetric, then it will not be identical. And one can also show that if calculating non-diagonal elements, then commutativity is even not valid for symmetric square matrices. So that was subtask A. Now we come to subtask B, the associativity for matrix products. So matrix products are not commutative, you cannot swap the order, but they are associative. That means you can priorize the calculation of effectors as you like. That means you can set the parentheses as you like. You can also leave out the parentheses. In particular, if you first calculate AB and then multiply the product of a resulting matrix AB with C, you get the same as if you first multiply BC and then multiply it from the left with A. It's not allowed to swap the order. You cannot calculate BC times A. So the order must be the same because it's not commutative, but it's associative. And it's sort of interesting because AB gives a completely different matrix than BC, so you cannot see any similarities. So how do you do it? Basically by explicit calculations. So if you have so just explicit, so for the first expression, let's see, we want to calculate the a component ij, then we have first to calculate ab, that is this sum over k times aik bkl, and then the product multiply with c, and this gives this. And if you do it in this way, you get the same. Basically, it boils down that you can swap the order of the scalars, the components, because here the scalar components, of course, you can they are commutative, so this boils down to this relation. So now we come to the subtask C. We want to show that E also distributivity is valid for general matrix products. Distributivity means that you can first calculate the sum and then multiply it with matrix. You can also multiply it out. That means distributivity essentially means you can multiply out products of matrices, products of matrix times vectors, and calculate the terms separately. So this is for a matrix times vector, and this is for a matrix times a matrix. So how do you show this? Basically, it follows directly from element-wise addition of vector and matrix components. So it's quite trivial because you add it element-wise. You can just express the components of a matrix and vector objects, and then it's quite evident. So now the next question, that is the binary switching property of the transposition operation. That is quite simple. That means the double transposition gives the original. That's also why it's called swapping or switching. Each of the transposed operations swaps rows and columns, and of course, by definition, as double swapping restores the original state. So double transposition is the original thing. That's why it's a binary switching property, on, off, and so on. So now comes an interesting and very powerful rule, the rule for the transpose of vectors and matrices. So that means if you transpose such a product, for example, matrix times vector, then and you want to have expression for the transposed isolated objects, then you can do it, but you need simultaneously swap the order. That also means it's commutating matrix products and matrix times vectors is a deadly sin, but if you commutate and simultaneously transpose, then you have a correct identity. So with the same also with matrix products, you can change the order, but only if you transpose them. So AB transposed equals B transposed A transposed. So how do you show this? So it's most intuitively done with again this figurative reasoning. So AB is rows of matrix A times the column vector B, and this whole thing is transposed. And now with of course, if you just calculate it, this will give inside the brackets, you will get a row vector, which shall be consisting of scalar products, scalar product of the first row of the matrix times B, up to a scalar product of the nth row of the matrix A times B. And this transposed, that of course gives this row vector. Now we do it the other way around. What gives B transposed A transposed? So it's just adopting the rule. Here we have AB transposed. We swap the order and we transpose each singular object B transposed A transposed. That's of course B transposed is a row vector. That's symbolized by these horizontal dashes multiplied with the transposed matrix, because with A were the rows matrix, if we have a transposed matrix, we have a columns. And we have again nice scalar products directly in the form of a row vector. So this shows this identity. For the matrix times matrix identity, it's best to directly calculate each object component wise. So we start with B transposed multiplied with A transposed, and we now want the component ij of it. Of course, I and j are, as indices, are already reserved. So in order to sum, we need new indices. And so we need, say, an index k, because in order to calculate the scalar products making up this matrix product. So we have the row of a b dash, that's just sum of a k of ik, times the columns of a dashed, that's just indices kj. And now we use the swapping property of the transposition. It means b dash ik is just bki, and the same with a dash kj is just ajki. And then we just swap the scalars. That means you can commute normal numbers. So we can write it in this way. And here you see this is a normal matrix product AB ji. And that of course, so with indices are swapped, we need to swap it again. By definition, this is again a transposition operation. We end up with this. So now we have shown this very important matrix calculation rule. So now two last points which will be relevant for econometric investigations. We often have a data matrix X. It's generally not symmetric, so it's just an arbitrary n times m matrix. And we often need the product X transpose times X. So first, this product exists, because when the number of columns of the first matrix is the number of rows of the second matrix, because the first is transposed, regardless of the dimensions of the two single matrices. And we want to show that the product, first we have now shown it exists, and we now show that it is symmetric. Symmetric just means the transposed object is the same as the non-transposed objects. So we want to show that this ij is this ji. How do we do it? We just apply this previous transposition rule. So x dash x transposed, then we swap the inputs, that means this will be the first, and also it gets a transposition, so it's this. And this will be the last in all this transpose, so it's double transposed, and then we now use a switching property that double transposed is the original, so we have just x dash x. So we have shown this is symmetric, because a transpose of this object is just the object itself. So now the last property, it's a very interesting property, because it says that if you first transpose a matrix and then invert it, it's the same as if you first invert the original matrix and then transpose it. And that's interesting, because the intermediate products, that means A trans to the minus 1, looks completely different to A transposed. So in a sort, this inversion more or less complements the transposition, so that you can swap the order of these two operations. So you can say the inversion and the transposition operation commute with each other. You can first apply the one, then the other, or you can do it the other way around. And we will need this identity quite often in the later in the analysis. So how do you show it? By definition of with a unit matrix. First, we remember the definition of a unit matrix, A to the minus 1 times A equals A times inverse of A is a unit matrix. And also, because a unit matrix is, of course, it's just a diagonal of ones, it's symmetric, so E transposed equals E. So we have, so first we can say E equals E transposed, and that equals A to the minus A times A transposed. And now we use the transposition rule and can write it in this way. So now we multiply this object with A transposed to the minus 1. If we do it with the left hand side, then we have just A transposed to the minus 1. If we do it with the right hand side, and using associativity, that means we can just first calculate A transposed to the minus 1 times A transposed. This gives unit matrix and remains A to the minus 1 transposed. And this basically gives this identity that the operations of transposition and the operation of inversion are commutative. That means they can be swapped in the order, giving the same result. We now come to a second problem, a matrix inversion. Here we will restrict to the simple inversion of a 2 times 2 matrix, and I also give a few hints of doing the 3 times 3 matrix for at home lesson. So we just consider general square 2 times 2 matrix with general elements A, B, C, and D. And we want to show that by means of matrix multiplication that the inverse of this matrix is given by the 1 over determinant of A, and then you swap the elements in the main diagonal, that means AD becomes DA. You leave the elements of the off diagonal, but multiplied with minus 1. And so that's the rule. So, swap the main diagonal, multiply the off diagonal with minus 1, and divide the whole thing by the determinant, and you got the inverse. And the determinant is of a 2 times 2 matrix is just product of the main diagonal minus product of the off diagonal values. And so it's quite easy. First, A is regular if this determinant exists, and that of course that is evident that a matrix product, that a matrix inverse only exists if A is regular, because otherwise you have a zero denominator, which is then not defined. And the rest is just using the matrix multiplication. This can be done by hand using Falk's scheme. Basically, it formalizes the operation of scalar products of the row of the first matrix per times column of the second matrix. So this, for example, in the row of the first matrix, the first row of the first matrix, the second row of the first matrix, and these are the columns of the second matrix, which is the inverse. And if you multiply it, you get this new matrix. So that's a general scheme valid for any matrix. And now we for this E, F, G, and H, we use the expressions for the inverse matrix, and then we just insert it, and then we see that it just calculates out that you will get a unit matrix. For example, A times A to the minus 1, the first, the 1-1 component is AE plus BG, and then we, for E and G, we just insert this. And then we get determinant A divided by determinant A equals 1. And if a determinant A would be 0, we get an expression 0 divided by 0, which of course is undefined. And the same we can also choose with more complicated expression in the problem statement for inverting 3 times 3 matrices. But this will not be relevant for examinations, so you will not really need to learn it. The final problem of this tutorial considers derivatives of vectors and matrices. First we start with a definition. Assume we have a scalar function. That means a scalar function just reciting a number, but this function depends on a vector beta. In our case, in econometrics, this beta will be a parameter vector. And you see how such expressions come from. It's just if we have some expression for the errors, for example, sum of squared errors, and we want to minimize this residual errors, then we, and if this f is this error function, then we have just to take the derivative of this function with respect to all parameters and set this derivative to zero, which is a necessary condition for a minimum. And this is just defined to be a vector. So usually it's a deadly sin to divide by a vector, because division is not defined in the original sense, only the inverse. And remember, inverse can only be calculated for square matrices. So unless you have a degenerated 1 times 1 matrix, there is not such a thing as an inverse of a vector. But here this is just a formal expression for the derivative, and it's just defined this way, so that this is a scalar function depending on a vector of parameters, and the derivative with respect to this vector gives normal column vector consisting of the first derivative with respect to the first component, second component, and so on. I started with beta 0, which is because in the linear regression where we will see this derivative, this is just the intercept, which means that beta 0 is a constant. So this is just a definition. So now the problem is, apply this definition to following scalar functions. The first scalar function is just the scalar product of the beta vector times a constant A, and the second function is just beta vector transposed times a square matrix A times a vector beta. And of course the vector A and the matrix A do not depend on beta, so that if we have a time as a beta derivative, we just need to take the derivatives with respect to the explicit parameters appearing here and here. So, and we want to show that the first function gives just the vector itself as a column vector, and the second function, this beta transposed A beta, gives A plus A transposed multiplied from the left with a vector B. How to show this? Just inserting the definition. So first, you can just use the first function. You say the first element of the resulting vector is just the derivative with respect to the first parameter beta zero of the sum. Because these different betas are independent from each other, so the derivative of beta j with respect to beta I is equal to zero unless j equals I. So here from all the sum, only the zero is picked out. And of course, d beta zero, the derivative to beta zero gives of course one. That means just a zero remains. And the same is for the other components. Only one component is picked out. With the last component, is just the last component picked out. So it's just a column vector of the components, or just with A itself. So for the same, the next we do the same. So it means this also gives a column vector, because this is a scalar. Vector times matrix times vector. Matrix times vector gives a vector. And this is scalar multiplied with this column, with this row vector giving a scalar. It means the derivative gives a column vector, and the first is just this double sum. So beta dash a to beta I wrote as a double sum, and this is with respect to here. And here we have again to see which betas are picked out. Let's start with the first one, beta zero. So we have two terms. This j can be zero. Then we have beta zero, a zero k beta k. It gives this expression, but also the k index can be zero. This gives the second term, and the same for these other derivatives. And you can write this first row just as the first row of this a times beta. And here the second term is just a dash times beta. So putting all together, we have just a plus a dash multiplied with the column vector b. Okay, that was it for this tutorial number two. Many thanks.